May it please the court, Kenneth Yoon representing plaintiffs Hamilton and Hernandez in class counsel. Your Honor, there are several issues as the court just noted. The first issue is the meal period. There's two issues there, certification and the jury's verdict. There is the overtime issue, which is primarily the defense of the alternative work week. There is then some lesser issues that I would like to also cover, such as the waiting time penalty issue, the individual claims being dismissed issue, the wage statement issue, pre-judgment interest, and the PAGA.
You're unlikely to get to all of that, it would be nice to know what you're going to concentrate on.
I'm going to concentrate on meals and then the alternative work week, and I'd like to, there's a few points I have, really one point or two each of the other issues, some none. I think the papers do speak for themselves. On the meal period issue, I think this is something that's important because I don't think it was as well emphasized by either of the parties, is that the standard for an appeal from a certification of a class action based upon California state law is that an abuse of discretion. And the cross appellant is arguing that the certification order is based upon the wrong reading of the law. But that's not even the standard. Because we're talking about a diversity action in federal court based upon California state law, what the district court was charged to do is to apply California law as the court believes the California Supreme Court would apply the law. And that's exactly—
And that's true as to the class action question?
Well, the law is—
Which is a procedural question?
It's a procedural question as to what law to apply. The meal break law should be read from the point of view of the California Supreme Court's interpretation, not—
Well, that part's true. That's true. But it's a legal question. I mean, abuse of discretion always incorporates a prong of legally incorrect. If it's legally incorrect, then it's an abuse of discretion, so we're back in the same place.
Except that the California Supreme Court is very clear on what it believes the reading of the California Labor Code is.
Well, that's fine. So we're just discussing a legal issue, so let's do that.
So on that issue, the California Supreme Court and the district court following Brinker says the standard for meal breaks. And the court almost literally copied verbatim the Brinker decision with respect to the jury instruction and how it fashioned the certification order. That's not an abuse of discretion.
The standard seems, it's the not impede or discourage that's kind of confusing things, because that suggests that if the time period is under the employer's control, is there something else that has to be shown in terms of not impede or discourage? The employer here is saying, well, many people weren't impeded or discouraged, and therefore you can't have a class because they actually went ahead and took the time. But my understanding of your argument is that the time they took was not an uninterrupted 30-minute break because they still had to spend time getting back in.
I think that's similar to what we're saying, but what we're saying is more class-based because it's the existence, the employer here sets forth the procedure for how they are going to handle the employee's meal breaks. And we're saying that the entire procedure had a class issue that impeded or discouraged the full provision of the meal break that the employer is required to provide. And that the common issues were the security check, how that worked, how that was a condition, et cetera. The facts of the security check, which are not in dispute. The facts of the security check are undisputed. The effects of the security check on any particular—
Why, this is what I'm having trouble with. Why does it matter whether people were discouraged from taking their break if the break they took was not the full 30 minutes? I'm sort of bouncing off the other case. If they had to spend time in the security checks and therefore which was part of that 30-minute break, then they weren't getting a 30-minute break. And why are we worrying about these, whether they actually took the time, went outside or didn't go outside?
That's Walmart's, that's the defendant's point of view.
I understand, but you're buying into this and Peter discouraged as a separate consideration, as I understand it.
Well, I apologize if we haven't been as clear, but the law in Brinker, and which is the law from the jury instruction and the law that the court based upon its ruling, is that the employer's obligation to provide a meal period to its employees, and that's the law. The employer has an obligation to provide. And then Brinker says further, the employer satisfies this obligation if it relieves its employees of all duty, relinquish control over their activities and permits them a reasonable opportunity to take an uninterrupted 30-minute break.
Counsel, can I stop you? I've got a procedural question here. Didn't you win on this issue?
We did.
Well, why are you starting with an issue on which you won? That this is the subject of Walmart's cross appeal. It's not your appeal. You're defending this judgment. I'm completely thrown off that you would take your time and start with what you won. Congratulations.
Thank you, Your Honor. We start with this because, I understand, Your Honor.
You're defending something that Walmart hasn't yet argued on oral argument yet. What you do want to argue about is whether the district court properly denied you the prejudgment interest on the $6 million the jury awarded you.
That is procedurally, I understand the court's point and the confusion. I'm apologizing we are the appellee on that issue. I understand the court's confusion on that. I just want to make a couple points then. That one of the facts then on the merits of the decision of the trial court, the jury, is that they found 100% violation rate. But then let me move on to the alternative work week and then the prejudgment interest. In terms of the alternative work week defense, we think that the elements of the claim are fairly simple, and I'd like to focus on, well, they're not very simple. The elements of the claim are complex and are very many, and there is not a tremendous amount of California Supreme Court law on these elements. But the two elements I'd like to focus on are the effect, how the disclosure by the employer to institute an alternative work week requires a disclosure in writing to all the affected employees, and the effects of the AWS on the wages, hours, and benefits. On the sick pay, the employer's disclosure said there is no effect, but the effect was that the employees who said yes to a 3 and 11 and a quarter hour schedule, 3 days, 11 and a quarter hours a day, was that they would now have 2.13 days of sick rather than 3 full days of sick.
And they were told that they were going to have 24 hours, so it was just a question of math, how much that was, right?
Well, that's
Your complaint seems to be that this 24 hours was illegal, that they should have had 3 days. But that's a different issue. That's a different challenge. It's not this one.
Well, I think it is part of this challenge. I disagree respectfully, but there's two points. First, that's the second point. Yes, it should have been more time. And that now the alternative work week will serve to give the employees less time than they're legally entitled to.
But second, not less time than they had before, and not, they were told how much time they would have, and it was correct, that was how much time they had. Actually, they ended up getting more time in the end, but they ended up with 30 hours, as I understand.
Well, still insufficient, but the primary issue on this is that the alternative work week schedule is not a simple, plain, we're going to do this, it'll be easy. The reason for this disclosure is because there are unforeseen, especially by lay employees, not wage and hour lawyers, HR professionals.
So are you arguing that they had to do the math and say that's 2.25 days? Is that your argument? Or is that they had to say, this is an illegal requirement because benefit, because we're really supposed to be giving you 30 days. What are you saying they should have done?
On the first point, the second point is similar to the court just mentioned second one. But the first point is this. The employer should have disclosed by voting on an alternative work week of 3 days and 11.25 hours a day, you will be getting fewer days of sick than you were without the alternative work week. And you will get 2.13 days. That's how it will affect your benefits. Your benefits will be affected in that way. And it's not obvious. It's not obvious to an employee who's been working a schedule, and then that a future schedule will change that benefit in that way, which now means that they won't have the opportunity to take 3 full days of sick. And instead, if they need to take
three... Why is it obvious that if you have 11-hour days and you get 24 hours of sick leave, that you don't get 3 full days?
Because the employer's disclosure said there's no change. The disclosure says no change.
There wasn't any change. You still get 24 hours of sick leave. That's not a change.
But
your clients surely should have been sophisticated enough to have understood that with very simple math, that 24 hours wasn't going to cover 3 days of work at 11:25 hours a day.
Well, first, I use the word change, but the law uses the word disclose the effects. And this is an effect. Whether the employer says it's not a change or is a change, this is an effect. This will affect your rights. You're effectively different.
Counsel, I want to make sure I understand where we are in the outline. You lost on this one before the jury.
Yes.
Is that correct? And then you filed the JMOL. So you're arguing here that the jury had no discretion and had to find in favor of your client, and therefore the district court was in error by not granting you a post judgment motion.
I don't know if I use those words, but we would ask this court to correct the proceedings.
We're going
to
override the jury.
That
takes quite a bit.
It admittedly, Your Honor, the procedural posture that you have just set forth is the procedural posture that we are in, and that's the request that we have. And we're saying that because
that what I'd like to hear about are the PAGA issues.
I would like to reserve 3 minutes. I have 5. I think I can adjust that in the time.
All right. Well, go ahead and do what you want. I'm telling you what I'd like to hear about.
Yes. On the there are a couple of other issues on alternative work week on this, and the next one is that we believe that in order to comply with the law, the defendant has to meet its burden to show what the alternative to the alternative. The employees can't understand the effects of the alternative unless they know what their alternative is if they say no. And here, the defendants expressly said that whatever schedule you're on now is not going to be your future schedule. So it's impossible for the voters to have known how that would have affected them because they don't know what the alternative is. They don't have an idea of what's going to happen if they say no. And in that sense, there just wasn't enough evidence. And the jury didn't necessarily get it wrong, but the jury, in a sense, of this sense, is the jury didn't factor in the strictness of the rule because
did you argue this to the jury? Did you argue to the jury that about the 24 and 30 days? Did you argue to the jury that this was that they should have had to give you the current schedule?
I believe we did, yes, Your Honor.
All right, so it was rejected by the jury.
Well, it was rejected by the jury, but at the same time, the evidence wasn't there in the first place. The final point I'd like to make is that there's an employee who didn't get the vote and who didn't get a vote and didn't get a disclosure, Ms. Schwartz, and the evidence that was supported that the employer used to support, we believe, is insufficient evidence that the jury couldn't have relied upon. It shouldn't have relied upon, and on that basis, it should be overturned. Now, then there's another issue here, which is respect for the alternative work week, is our inability to bring in evidence. And I'll skip to the main one, which is we had an employee who said he showed up to work on the day of the vote and he was turned away. The court thought that person, that fact suggested foul play. The standard here is arbitrary. And well, one of the standards here is arbitrariness. And we think it's arbitrary that the trial court thought it was foul play and then denied us the ability to introduce foul play at the trial court proceeding. We think that as well, the other 33 people who were to start work the day after the vote would have been important. Would have that denial of evidence prejudiced our ability to argue this issue to the jury. And on that point, we should have another opportunity. With respect to the prejudgment interest, we're asking for 7%. The law is very clear now, 7% for meal break claims like ours. It wasn't that clear until September 2019. We filed 28 days after judgment. We filed for the 7% on 10-2, 2019. The judgment was 9-4, 2019. We're within the 28 days. And the fact that, well, And there is a dispute as to the briefing before that. It's in the papers. With respect to the waiting time penalty, if the district court finds a lack of subject matter jurisdiction, a lack of Article III standing, the remedy is to remand. The court's without jurisdiction to enter a judgment against the plaintiffs on that point. On the individual claim, our clients...
The waiting time penalties depends on... an overtime claim?
Overtime claims.
So that depends on the AWS issue?
Yes.
Okay.
On the individual claim, there's a timing issue here, and the court made an error. We never dismissed or we never stated we are not seeking the individual overtime claim for the walking time and the security check time. That was decertified on March 4th. The conversations referenced occurred before then. We didn't, in anticipation or do a contingent future dismissal, or contingent future waiver. We, in order to waive a claim, it needs to be knowing and intentional. That's not what happened here. It's just error.
These conversations were in meet and confers. Is that what they were?
Yes.
They weren't memorialized anywhere. They're not in any status report or anything else, right?
Correct. But no, that, I believe that it may be in the final pretrial conference order, which predates the decertification order.
Okay.
On the wage statements, on the PAGA claim, Your Honor, the court found that against us on the PAGA claim and dismissed that from the outset of the case. On that point, we believe that the PAGA is a different animal than a typical claim and that the disclosure was sufficient. The disclosure is very simple. The number of work weeks and the number of work weeks are presented in the expert report. The fact that the amount of damages that we would request are in the expert report. And there was sufficient evidence for the defendant and plaintiff to try the case based upon those numbers.
So the problem was district court said you didn't satisfy Rule 26. And it looks like it was just a matter of simple math. So sort of picking up, telling us how much you were going to claim for each claim and multiplying it by whatever number of claims or plaintiffs you had. Now, did you do that?
I don't believe we did the final mathematical computation on the PAGA or the waste.
But it's a set, the fine is a set amount, right?
Yes.
And you had the number of hours in an expert report.
It's not an hours base, it's a work week base, or the pay period base, rather. So we had the pay period.
A what base?
The penalty is a fixed amount per work or per pay period, per paycheck.
Okay, and you had that somewhere in an expert report?
Yes, Your Honor, we did.
All right, so basically, and also, what does the rule say? It talks about damages, right?
The rule talks about damages, and this is a little bit different.
Well, it's not a little bit different. It's not damages.
Yes, that's correct. That's our position, yes, Your Honor.
All right, what about the class action issues, which are the ones that interest me and which you don't want to talk about? My understanding is that the district judge said that it had to be certified as a class and wasn't manageable anyway. Is that right?
The PAGA claims, yes. The district court applied class action standards to the PAGA claim, which expressly doesn't have that. Yes, Your Honor. And separately, though, in terms of manageability, it's very largely derivative, and the manageability of the actual claim was managed fairly well. So in hindsight, we can see that I believe it's manageable.
All right, you are down to 57 seconds. I'll give you an additional minute. Do you want to reserve the rest?
Thank you, Your Honor.
Ms. Evangelos.
May it please the court, DNA Evangelos for Walmart. I'd like to begin with Walmart's appeal on the meal break discouragement claim, and then I'll turn to the issues in plaintiff's appeal.
Well, tell me why you're creating it as if it's a subjective, individualized standard. But if the meal break requires you to go through a security check. And that takes more than zero amount of time. And it's under the control of the employer. Why isn't that the end of the story? Why do we have to worry about whether people would or wouldn't have taken the break or were annoyed by it or whatever?
Your Honor, I think we should start with plaintiff's theory of this case, which
I'd like to hear the answer to that question. As a legal question, as a legal matter.
Yes, as a legal matter, Brinker says that the employer's duty is to relieve employees of all duty and to provide the break, not ensure that it's done, and that they cannot discourage or impede the taking of that break, but that's the extent of it. And what Brinker cited for the cases that it discussed in this section of the opinion at page 1040 is Jaimez, Siqueiros, and Dilt. Those were cases where there was evidence, strong evidence, that employees were prevented from taking breaks and that there was an actual discouragement where they didn't take the breaks. Here, the theory is not—
But those were in situations where, for example, there were they had too much work to do or they were had to stay on the telephone or whatever, right? Here, we're talking about a situation in which some amount of the time for the break is being taken up by having to go through security check. So it's a different kind of circumstance. It's not simply a question of making it difficult to take the break. It's taking up some of the time during the break. And I don't understand why we're not just finished at that point.
Well, actually, Your Honor, here the evidence showed that at most times there were 0.0 seconds to go through this very minimal
security. I mean, it's impossible. It doesn't take no time to do something.
That was actually plaintiff's expert report, and I will point the court to page 1715 of the excerpts of record, where he examined the busiest times, and even he found that 6 out of the 8 times that were the busiest times of day that he examined, the time it took 0 seconds. It was a simple metal detector walkthrough. It was only when employees went out to break and they had a 5-minute grace period. That is on page 918 of the excerpts of record. There's undisputed evidence at trial about that grace period. So that's what takes this really out of the realm of the cases the plaintiffs are relying on, where there were very long security checks, like in the Apple case that was discussed also in the prior argument. There were allegations that a security check took up to 45 minutes. This is a general structural feature of the workplace at this facility in Chino that was not in any way aimed at meal breaks.
And when you say the expert said 6 out of 8, what are the other 2 out of 8?
Other 2 out of 8 times were 0.02 seconds, and the other time was 1.6 seconds.
And all of this evidence was presented to the jury, right?
No, Your Honor, this was at class certification. So we're talking about the certification of this claim and why there was no evidence that on a class-wide basis, people were actually discouraged or impeded from taking their breaks. So the whole theory here was not a compensable time theory. It was that this security check was a discouragement. And the evidence at trial was, again, the 5-minute grace period. And we had 4 plaintiffs testify. And from their testimony, half of them said that they went outside. They were not discouraged from going outside. So we know that this was not a situation where there was class-wide evidence, no common proof of any kind. And I do want to point to this court's decision in De Leon versus Time Warner. That's an incredibly important case here. There was a policy to finish calls before going on meal break. The plaintiff alleged that because of that policy, he did not take his meal breaks. Now, the court didn't just stop there. It didn't accept that on its face. It looked at the evidence and said, well, actually, in effect, he didn't go on his breaks because it could have been that, but it could have been also his own choice. There's no evidence to show that the reason he skipped his break was because of that employer policy.
There is evidence here to show that some people said it was because of this.
I'm sorry?
Some people did say that the reason they didn't leave the premises was because of the security check.
That's correct. Your Honor, Ms. Hernandez and Plaintiff Cabrera said that. So there was split testimony at trial. But of course, Hernandez and Cabrera's experience can't be extrapolated to the entire class. We know because Hamilton and Vidiana did go outside. And the court can just look at its supplemental excerpts of record 64.
Did they testify that they went outside every day?
Hamilton went outside almost every day except for the first day when she didn't, and she said she took her break outside most of the time, and there was some conflict between her deposition testimony and trial testimony, but she went out most of the time. Vidiana said, "I was never stopped from going outside. Not a single time did I feel I couldn't go outside." So we know that there were break room amenities. There was extensive testimony about that as well, where there were cell phone chargers, air conditioning, and other amenities in the break room. So what we have here is no dispute over the fact that Walmart authorized and provided meal breaks, and there's no dispute that employees got the full time of their breaks. What the plaintiff's theory is that going through the security check on the way out was enough of a discouragement on a class-wide basis such that everybody here suffered a violation. But of course, we know—
Was it only on the way out or also on the way in?
It was only on the way out. So they would go out, and on the way in, they did not have to go through it. But this claim is one of discouragement, that alone discouraged people. But we know there was a 5-minute grace period, and we know that the high watermark—
What does that mean?
I'm sorry?
What exactly does that mean?
It means that employees had a 5-minute, so they had a 30-minute meal break, but they had an extra 5 minutes. It was a grace period. So it was really 35 minutes that they could come back in. But we know from plaintiff's own expert testimony that the high watermark of wait times was about one minute. It was a matter of 0 seconds in most cases. So it's really not at all the case here that this was any sort of objectively discouraging policy. And so where you have a situation like this, where it is a structural feature of the workplace, Your Honor, to accept plaintiff's theory would really invite a slippery slope. One can only imagine that placing a cafeteria on one side of an office park, or perhaps a long elevator ride, any of those.
But then you're getting to the merits. As I understand it, when you get to the merits, you have the problem that the jury found whatever it found. Right.
Well, we think, Your Honor, that here there's a class certification problem.
I know. So that argument, the one that you're making now, is a merits argument. It's not a class certification argument.
But we need to understand
the staircases, and what about the so and so?
Well, in that situation, it would be the same problem, where there might be that one employee who said, "I was discouraged by it." You'd have to weigh all the evidence.
Like, yeah, but it isn't anything imposed by the employer. This is what we discussed in the other case. So.
Well, it would be imposed by the employer in the sense that it was a structural feature of the workplace. But even just putting those all aside here, we have a very, again, it was a minor inconvenience for some, but this is not the sort of thing that in practice resulted in actual discouragement on a class-wide basis. And we know that there are individuals within this class who suffered no violation and no injury. For example, Mr. Vidiana. So under this court's decision in Olean, as well as Ramirez versus TransUnion, it would be improper to allow this verdict, this class-wide verdict, to stand, where we know that this sweeps in uninjured members. So we know that these individuals were not in any way injured, and under this court's decision in De Leon, for example, I think summary judgment would have been granted to Walmart, and based on all the evidence and their testimony. So you have to look at the effects on the individual. This is not a case. Plaintiffs cited some cases, Your Honor, where in Bradley and Falkenberry, for example, there was a policy that facially violated the meal break laws. That is totally distinguishable from what we have here. This is a practice that on its face doesn't violate anything. You have to look at in practice whether it resulted in discouragement. And Bringer used the language, it said that in these cases, Siqueiros, Diltz, and Jaimez, there was evidence. The evidence showed that the policy made it extremely difficult to take breaks. That's at page 1040 of Brinker. So again, we have to look at, did this feature make it, or policy make it, extremely difficult for everyone in this class to take their break outside? No dispute they took breaks, no dispute they got the time of their breaks, but did it discourage them so much? So we believe that certainly at a minimum, this should be decertified, because there was no common proof that every single person in the class was so discouraged. So I and I will turn, and Your Honor, I do believe that there's also, we should be granted judgment as a matter of law because plaintiffs didn't meet their burden of class-wide proof under Amgen. That would be appropriate, but at a minimum, I think that it is at a minimum necessary to decertify the class. So I do want to mention that. I can turn next to plaintiff's appeal unless the court has further questions.
Yes, please.
Thank you. So on the alternative work schedule implementation, here the jury found by a preponderance of the evidence that Walmart satisfied all of the requirements for implementing the alternative work schedule. That's supported by ample substantial evidence and it should be affirmed. I am happy to answer any questions that the court has about that in particular, but I think Judge Berzon, Judge Bivey, you are exactly right that the hours of sick leave were 24 hours before and after. There was no change. And in fact, Walmart always calculated sick leave in hours. And that's testimony at trial on page 928. That was the way Walmart always calculated and offered sick leave. So of course that did not change. It was still 24 hours before and after, and even later on it went up. So I would be happy to answer any questions about that, but I also wanted to leave time to address the PAGA claim because Your Honor had questions about that. I can turn to that next.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Your Honor. So first, the district court correctly held that plaintiffs had failed to disclose the calculation of PAGA penalties. And
well, first of all, these are not damages, they're penalties, is that right?
That is right, Your Honor. And under the advisory—
So why do they have to be disclosed?
Under the advisory committee notes of Rule 26, it says that it applies to damages and, quote, other monetary relief. That's within
this
Rule
isn't
26.
Monetary relief either, it's a penalty.
It is monetary relief, Your Honor, in that it's a—
It's monetary, but it's not relief.
Well, I would argue that it is relief, and the district court was correct here in finding that plaintiffs had not disclosed anything. And here,
well, they did disclose, apparently. Did they not disclose the number of what's the metric here? It's days or what is the metric that PAGA uses?
Well, Your Honor, you would have to look at whether there was a violation in each pay period. So it isn't just a matter
of— Did they have any information as to what pay periods they were talking about?
They claim that their expert's report included this information, but again, their expert didn't actually do this math. There were the input.
Well, it didn't do the math. It didn't multiply the number of pay periods by the amount of the fine, but the fine's a set amount. So what's the problem?
Well, the problem, Your Honor, is that you'd have to look at whether there was a violation in each pay period and what was their theory, but it's not our job to do the math and reverse engineer.
The fact that you have to multiply the number of pay periods by 1,000 it means that they didn't disclose it?
Well, the district court found that they did not properly disclose it, Your Honor, and I think the district court did not abuse its discretion. This is a discretionary determination by the district court, and plaintiffs do not on appeal challenge the appropriateness of the sanction that the district court applied under Rule 37. So that is waived, I believe here the district court was well within its discretion to hold that plaintiffs had not preserved this. And I can address other questions that the court had as well about the PAGA claim, but I think that is the fundamental reason here why plaintiffs were not able to bring.
Tell us how you're prejudiced. What figures didn't you get?
Well, Your Honor, we're prejudiced because, again, this is not a simple calculation. You do have to see what plaintiffs are alleging is a violation in each pay period. And for the off-the-clock claim, for example, where we know that there was evidence that there was 0.0 seconds wait for many, they had no measure of how they were going to determine whether someone actually worked off the clock, how they would
count. But they gave you you can contest whether those were violations, but they, the experts did say what, how many pay periods they thought there were. Oh, shoot. Oh, I'm sorry. I just went off for a minute. Did the expert, what was in the expert report? Was there a claim as to what, how many pay periods there were violations on?
I believe so, Your Honor. And
right. And then after that, unlike the usual damages situation where you have to have damages connected to each of those for individual people and based on pay rates and so on, here, after you know that, you basically have the answer. Is that right?
Well, no, Your
Honor.
As
to what they're claiming, all the Rule 26 requires is that they tell you what they're claiming.
Well, Your Honor, there is a separate problem that I want to flag for the court as well, and that plaintiffs said they were not going to pursue PAGA claims for any uncertified claims. So that was a second reason why the district.
But they said that before this, as to the uncertified claims, they were uncertified when they said it.
Well, Your Honor, Walmart argued that the PAGA claims were unmanageable and therefore could not proceed. And plaintiffs said, don't worry about that. We're not going to pursue any PAGA claims for any uncertified claims. The district court therefore did not entertain any of Walmart's arguments on that because it agreed, it believed plaintiffs and the district court and Walmart were lulled into believing that they were not going to pursue any PAGA claims for any uncertified claims. And the district court heard that. The district court was there and it was managing this trial throughout, and it was not an abuse of discretion for it to understand plaintiff's position to be that way. And plaintiffs made an about face on the eve of trial, and the district court was right to say, and I don't think
the district court certified the class of on the eve of trial.
Actually, well, I'm talking, Your Honor, about the off the clock claim, and for the off the clock claim that was decertified. Excuse me.
On the eve of trial. Because,
yeah, it was decertified, and the plaintiffs have not appealed decertification.
Right.
Of that.
When was it decertified relative to the, after the statement was made, right?
It was decertified after the statement was made, but the district court understood plaintiff's counsel's statement assurance.
But the district court then went on to make legal rulings, which is that they had to meet the class actions requirements and that they had to meet a manageability requirement, right?
Well, that's, Your Honor, first, the district court found that under Rule 26, they couldn't bring them. So I think that is the cornerstone of the district court's ruling. It also held that the claims were not manageable. But again, this is the flaw that pervades all of the PAGA issues is the Rule 26 problem. And then the fact that we do believe that it was not manageable. There were wide disparities in wait times and no evidence that across the board, every single member of this class suffered a violation, and that's why it was decertified. Plaintiffs have not appealed that, so it really would be inconsistent for a PAGA claim to go forward where there's no way of determining whether there's liability in all of those pay periods. I can also address the prejudgment interest issue if the court would like.
Please do. I would like that, and may go over your time a little on that.
Thank you. So here plaintiffs, again, the district court did not abuse its discretion by rejecting plaintiffs' third attempt to seek prejudgment interest through Rule 59E. In this court's decision in Kona Enterprises, of course, we know that Rule 59E is not for arguments that could have been raised earlier. And here, this was their third bite at the apple. So they first sought 10% under the breach of contract claim in a request for prejudgment interest after trial. The court rejected that. Then they submitted another file seeking 7% under the UCL. They never mentioned Section 3287 at all earlier. And so really here, it was not an abuse of discretion for the court to say, well, look, you had two bites at the apple. You never raised this provision until now. And this is not a vehicle for arguments that could have been raised earlier. It's to be used sparingly. It's a form of reconsideration, and it should be limited. And so here, there is also no dispute, I would argue, that Rule 3287 doesn't apply because, of course, damages were an issue that was given to the jury. So they're not capable of being readily ascertained. There was no sum certain. It's not a case where there was a clear sum. So
I don't understand that point. You mean, but the jury came up with a sum certain.
They did, but where an issue has to be tried to the jury, Your Honor, there's under California law in Duale versus Mercedes-Benz, for example, 3287 applies where there is no dispute between the parties on the computation of damages. Here, evidence had to be presented to the jury, cross-examined, and there was a dispute at trial over the amount, so it would not be capable of being readily ascertained. So for that reason, we believe that that provision doesn't even apply. But more importantly,
let me go back to PACA for a minute. Did the district court rely on the judicial estoppel that you're claiming? I think not.
Your Honor, the rulings were in the pretrial conference, and I...
But not with regard to why he did, as to this particular claim that they're now trying to bring the PACA penalties on. That wasn't the reason that he denied.
I don't recall, Your Honor, if that's in his reasoning. I will check it.
My understanding is not, and that you're bringing it up. You argued to him, but he didn't rely on it. Okay, your time is up. Is that, do either of my colleagues have questions? Thank you. Mr. Yoon.
You need to unmute.
You're muted.
Thank you, Your Honor. To address some of the issues in basically order,
can I ask whether the basic representation of the record with regard to the meal times are accurate? That is, that there was a grace period, that there that they and that for the, I don't know if I should say the majority, but for many of the plaintiffs, there was very little time, zero time spent on the security.
To respond to that, Your Honor, that's a new argument brought up by the defendants, the appellants, in the fourth brief before the court. For that reason, it should be disregarded. Secondarily, the employee at the ER at 139, the appellant filed a motion in limine to exclude evidence of how long it takes to go through a security check. And now on appeal, they want to talk about how long it takes to go through a security check, which is the very fact that I was specifically instructed not to be able to introduce to the jury at trial. So I think it's unreasonable to now go into that fact that was by the appellant's own request.
The judge very emphatically told you not to do that.
The plaintiffs listened to the court on that based upon that ruling that was requested by the appellant on this subject. So secondarily, Rodriguez v. Nike, seconds matter, 0.0 is disputed. There was facts as to how the security check went. The defendant had the opportunity to show there walking through security check takes no time, and that was impeached at trial. The case of
so
AMN.
That's a bad question for the jury, essentially.
It was argued to the jury, not expressly because we couldn't say it took X amount of seconds, but the jury was able to see how quickly some people went through that the defendant chose and how the process worked, which was the same process for everybody. The effect on any particular day might be longer or shorter depending on how they dressed. If somebody dresses in a one piece, that is different. But that's not the issue that was certified. And I'm over my time, but if I could, in the Brinker case, the law is very clear. It's did the employer provide the meal? That's it. That is the standard. Then there are other elements to that. Case was certified on that standard. Did the employer provide the meal? And the common issue that was predominant was the process to leave the facility was subject to this interference by the defendant. They didn't provide the meal because of their system that they set up. I think it's similar to us, and the defendants want a actual prevent standard, because if you look at a subjective standard, in actuality, it has to be an actual prevent. They claim that when you leave, that means you weren't prevented, and that's somehow relevant. But if similar to like a cigarette tax, if the state imposes a tax on cigarettes and someone continues to smoke, that doesn't mean he wasn't discouraged or impeded from smoking. It just means he decided to pay the tax and buy the cigarettes. If UCLA scores a touchdown on USC, it doesn't mean they weren't impeded or discouraged from scoring a touchdown. It just means that they were able to succeed despite that. You don't look at the, that's the standard that they're asking. They're asking for an actual prevent. And interestingly, in the facts of this case, 100% violation in terms of manageability. It's not terribly difficult to add up the numbers when you just multiply by 1.0, because that's the amount of violation. In terms of the 5-minute grace, that's disputed. That was disputed at trial. It was a 30-minute meal break. That was the policy. That was the policy at trial, and that was the evidence we provided. The defendant had their argument about this grace period and what it means, but the evidence was disputed that it was a 30-minute meal break, and that's what the policy
was. All right, you're well over your time. Is there anything else you're really anxious to tell us?
In terms of the structural feature, the defendant created the sexual feature.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Thank both of you for helpful arguments. In a complicated case, Hamilton versus Walmart Stores is submitted, and we are in recess for the day and adjourned for the week. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
This court for this session stands adjourned.